outside smell.
Oh, that would be me. I've been swimming in raw sewage. I love it. I love it. That's the signal. Let's go. Do it.
Been a great day, but now it's going to be a beautiful night as it's time for another episode of Trimming the Musical Fat. I'm Stephen Nicholson.
And I'm Paul Nicholson.
And together with our guests, we're going to be putting a musical rhyme to right by trimming an album we think is too damn long. In this episode, we take on Macca, the music legend that is Paul McCartney, and his late 20th century highlight, 1997's Flaming Pie. An album heavily inspired by McCartney's work on the Beatles' mid-90s anthology series. In turn, he then produced one of his best solo outings. What's going to make the TTMF supercut of Flaming Pie? If You Wanna, Heaven on a Sunday, Young Boy? So why are we doing this? Well, album runtime started to increase as CDs started to become the most popular format for consumers. This allowed artists to make their albums longer. But just because you can doesn't mean you should. And there are countless examples of albums that should have been better with a bit of pruning before their release. So with this podcast, with Flaming Pie, what we're going to do is we're going to try and make the album better by discussing the songs on the album and taking off the songs that we feel are not up to the standard of the best songs on that album. Along the way, we'll also share our personal experiences, the critical reception to the album, sales figures, chart positions, and some interesting fun facts from the year of the album's release, which was 1997. So there are three golden rules we need to follow with each album, and which we will do with Flaming Pie. So the album must be no longer than 50 minutes. For the tracks selected, they must be resequenced for the best listening experience. And tracks recorded at the same time as the album, but which did not feature, can be included. So that could be alternative versions, remixes, A or B sides. Tracks perhaps not officially released until years later, maybe those that were put on compilation or movie soundtracks instead. Ultimately, what we'll end up with is the under 50 minute TTMF supercut of Paul McCartney's Flaming Pie album. Well, breaking with tradition, we've only got one guest this week, the man who really wanted to be Paul McCartney's divorce lawyer, Paul Murphy. How are you, Paul?
Good evening. Yeah, good. I'm great, thank you.
Good, you ready to unleash hell on the title track tonight?
Oh, I am looking forward to this one. It's been a long time since I've listened to it, and I think it's opened up a lot of wounds.
Oh, wow. Okay, we look forward to hopefully hearing about them, but not seeing them. And before we get to it, well, we're obviously discussing Paul McCartney tonight, so let's take the opportunity perhaps to discuss his most recent album, which was released, was it December? I think it was. So McCartney III.
December the 18th.
Oh, well, thank you very much, Stato, for that one. And so McCartney III, I've actually so far only listened to it once, so I can't really provide any great critique on it. But what about you guys? Maybe Paul Murphy, I know you've listened to it a few times. What was your take on it?
I mean, I guess it's like a lot of things with McCartney these days. A bit disappointed. To me, it's not a true McCartney album, as in like the third part of McCartney 1 and 2, where he played everything on it, because I think a couple songs were outtakes from Egypt Station and had other people playing on it. I mean, at least he was experimenting and trying to do some things a bit differently, but I don't think it deserved the sort of like the critical accolades that it got. It felt a bit underwhelming, really. Some good songs on it, but yeah, kind of not quite. I'd rather listen to McCartney II, to be fair, which is at least experimental, you know, of the time, 1980s, 1979 was recorded. So yeah, not great. Okay. I'll give it a D+.
Oh, well. Okay, what about you, other Paul?
I think it's decent, but yeah, like Paul Murphy, yeah, I think it's too, yeah, I don't know, just a bit hyped up, and because it was marketed well, but I think the sad thing is with a lot of McCartney's latest albums, his last albums, tend to listen to them maybe once or twice, and then you put them away for a while, and you don't really go back to them, so it's good. It's on a par with Egypt Station, you know, but nothing amazing.
Something that seems to be sort of like that McCartney seems to suffer from a bit now is, you know, going back as part of this, looking at like what some of the reviews were at the time for Flame Buying albums afterwards, there's a bit of, it feels like the same thing with David Bowie, you know, it's like every review comes out, this is the best album he's done in years, this is the best album he's done since Flowers in the Dark. Yeah. And then the next album comes out and says, no, this is the best album that he's done since Flowers in the Dark. And Irina go, but you just said that the last album was like the greatest one ever. And I was like, actually, that's not as good. So yeah, it does feel a bit of that where it's like, no, this is the best album he's done in years. And actually, yeah, till the next one comes along and that'll be the best album that you've done in years.
Okay, so we're talking, it's half decent, but no more than that.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you for that, guys, and thanks for joining, Paul. We really love you.
Which Paul is how you speak to? What's your brother?
I'll say it to both. And I'll see how many other song titles from Flaming Pie I can shoehorn into the pod tonight. And I'll also do my best to try not to be distracted by things flashing up on my iPad here with Man United in a European semi-final, and I'm doing a podcast. That's almost sacrilegious not watching it. So I'll do my best to not be distracted. Okay, it's time for the tale of the tape. Flaming Pie, the 10th studio album from Paul McCartney. It was released in May 1997 and preceded by the single Young Boy. This was the follow-up to 1993's critically and commercially disappointing Off the Ground album. The album had multiple producers, including ELO Supremo Jeff Lynne, Beatles producer George Martin, and McCartney himself. The cover of the album, the original album design, was done by the team, and all photography, as is normal, is done by Linda McCartney. There are 14 songs on the album, and they are the song we were singing, The World Tonight, If You Wanna, Some Days, Young Boy, Calico Skies, Flaming Pie, Heaven on a Sunday, Used to Be Bad, which is bad, Souvenir, Little Willow, Really Love You, Really Don't, Beautiful Night,
Great Day.
Okay, so that's the 14 songs on it. The album is 54 minutes in duration, which means we need to lose at least 4 minutes today. There were 3 singles released from the album, but bizarrely, only one was released in the US. All 3 that were released worldwide were, and in the UK, the 3 that were released were all UK top 40 hits. So they were Young Boy, The World Tonight, which was the only US single, and Beautiful Night.
So the critical reception to Flaming Pie was strong, with McCartney achieving his best reviews since 1982's Tug of War, with fresh credibility with young fans who had been introduced to him through the Beatles anthology. It debuted at number 2 in the UK and US album charts. It was his first top 10 US album entry since Tug of War in 1982 also. It was kept off the UK number 1 spot by Spice, by the Spice Girls.
Quite right.
So the sales info for Flaming Pie were 1.86 million copies sold worldwide. That was 630,000 less than Off the Ground.
That's really surprising, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that's
25% reduction.
Yeah, so that was the thing with reading about the, when I was looking at his album sales and how I was really surprised at how much less Flaming Pie sold compared to Off the Ground. Like, as you were saying, Stephen, it was critically, it didn't do very well critically, but it's deemed as being a commercial failure. Yet it Flaming Pie, which was seen as a big commercial success, is his joint second lowest selling album up until that point. It sold the same amount as Wings Wildlife.
Wow.
The worst selling album at that point was Press to Play, 800,000 copies. And yet it's just, because it did so well in the UK and did so well in the US, I think we think it did really well, but it did really badly internationally compared to Off the Ground, which had I Hope a Deliverance was a top 10 single in Europe and in Latin America. And it was his biggest international single since Say, Say, Say. And yet we think of it as being a failure.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, it did quite well.
Yeah, no. Now, and remind me, did he tour around the time of Flaming Pie?
No.
With Off the Ground very heavily, didn't he? So that would have supported the album considerably.
Yeah, but I think Paul's right. Part of the reason for it was that Off the Ground sold really well in Europe, and in mainland Europe it sold really well, and particularly Hope of Deliverance single. So it sold really well there, and that's why, because it done so well chart position wise in the UK and the US, we sort of think of it as this massive seller, but actually, 25% less copies than its predecessor Off the Ground. So yeah,
Flowers in the Dirt sold 3.5 million copies, so it sold half the copies of that, which was 1989. The singles, the sales of it was one of the most astonishing things. Looking at it from reading about it, it's just
I wonder though
how little it may be sold.
I wonder though at that time. When you think about from 89, Flowers in the Dirt to Off the Ground, and then when it got to 97, I wonder the way people bought music had changed, and I wonder if that played an impact, or maybe
I'm
just looking for excuses.
Yeah, not 97. CDs I think that was probably getting to the era of when CDs were at their biggest sales, really. I mean,
No, I don't think there's any excuses in that respect, because streaming and such like really hadn't kicked in. So, less interest.
The Ground was the New World Tour, which I think was only North America and Australia, wasn't it? I don't think he toured Europe at all. Or I don't think
that's right.
American up there, did he?
I think it comes back to a hit single, doesn't it? If you've got a hit single, the first single is a big hit, your album generally... Yeah. Will do better, and that wasn't the case with this, was it? So, come home to roost.
Do you know what's an interesting fact is that, like we were talking about, Flaming Pie sold 1.86 million copies. In Europe, Off the Ground sold 1.43 million copies in Europe alone.
Mm-hmm.
That shows you the difference, where it sold half the amount in Europe compared to Off the Ground.
Mm. Well, interesting stuff. Didn't think that, but there we go.
I know, I was a bit shocked, I have to say.
Mm-hmm.
So what's also quite telling as well is that in terms of certifications for UK and US, it was gold for both. And you normally think of McCartney albums as at least platinum, and it was both gold certificates. And the streaming figures, where it gives you, not just the streaming figures, but the equivalent sales, if it was converted into albums, Flaming Pie was 14,222 sales, which is interesting. The other way around is over 5,500 more than Off the Ground, which is a 40% increase on Off the Ground. So one side of it, the sales figures are different on a different platform, the sales figures are like the opposite.
But I wonder how much that comes down to. I mean, I don't think, has McCartney ever really promoted off the ground at all? He's not done it as part of his archives, has he? He's kind of sort of like forgotten about the album.
What album?
Yeah, he's not off the... I think he promoted it well at the time. I remember when it came out in 93.
But since then, it's one of those albums he just doesn't really talk about, does he?
No.
No.
Stuff in it.
There is, actually.
Well, I mean, again, which is surprising considering it actually sold fairly well. Maybe, you know, just not in America and maybe not so well in Britain, but actually globally it did quite well.
In Latin America as well, I think.
Yeah, but he just never talked about it.
I think it's because of songs like Biker Like an Icon and Peace in the Neighborhood. That's probably why.
Undoubted classics.
Yeah. And what's quite interesting, I'll ask you guys, what do you think was the most streamed song?
I would have thought Young Boy.
From Flaming Pie? Okay. Beautiful Night?
No, Great Day. You wouldn't expect that, would you?
No. I mean,
Was that on the McCartney compilation that came? Was it like not Essential McCartney or something like that came out a few years ago?
Yeah, it might be because of that. But that's got the most sales on from the album, or the equivalent sales.
That's bonkers because it's really very much a throwaway type one, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh well.
Only lasts about 2 minutes. Four,
I know.
But yeah, it's quite interesting.
But apparently still too long for Paul Murphy.
Oh, way too long. Yeah, it's on Pure McCartney.
That might explain it then. Yeah.
So the top 10 selling singles in the UK in 1997 were at 10, Spice Up Your Life by the Spice Girls.
People on the World.
At 9, Tub Thumping by Chumbawamba. At number 8, Torn by Natalie and Billy. At number 7, Don't Speak by No Doubt.
Okay.
At number 6, Men in Black by Will Smith. At number 5, The Teletubbies Say A-O by The Teletubbies.
Perfect what a classic Day. That is.
Perfect Day was number 4, and that was various artists for charity. Number 3, it was I'll Be Missing You by Puff Daddy. At number 2, the classic Barbie Girl by Aqua. And at number 1,
Elton John.
I think it sold 33 million copies, that's right. Candle on the Wind.
Goodbye, England's Rose.
So what do you think about those singles then, guys?
Oh, it's quite an eclectic mix there, isn't it?
It's yes.
Just slightly.
I mean, it maybe explains why, you know, like, by that point, could Paul McCartney ever have a hit single, you know, when you're up against the Teletubbies?
Well, I think
John managed it, I suppose.
It's like one legend against the other, isn't it? McCartney versus the Teletubbies.
Well, I think
there's only one winner.
Yeah, Paul McCartney's last top 10 UK single was Once Upon a Long Ago in 1987 in the UK. And his last American one, I think, was Spies Like Us.
Oh, wow.
That's unbelievable, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You're talking...
Long time.
Yeah. 35 years.
40 years ago.
Yeah, yeah.
Long time. But then you could say the same thing.
He did that one with Kanye West, didn't he?
Yes.
Yeah, but like he's like a song on his own. Yeah.
Yeah. It's, I think, you know, but that, you could say the same thing about a lot of acts who you would, you know, call perhaps legacy act. You know, Bob Dylan, Rolling Stones, all these kind of acts that have been around. Even the likes of Madonna now. You know, Madonna isn't getting top 10 hits anymore.
That's right.
So this just seems to be a thing that happens, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I'll go into the.
Oh, sorry, I was going to say, just with those songs there, I actually owned 5 of those songs, the CD singles.
Mm.
And Teletubbies was not one of them, criminally.
Do you not think that was the...
Your life was.
I did own that. That was a cracking song. People are the world. Spice up your life.
Do you not think that was the peak for CD singles around that time? That was kind of the peak for that format, do you think?
Maybe. But yeah. I mean, there's some good stuff in there. All joking aside, I really like Spice Up Your Life. Torn by Natalie Imbruglia is a great song, as is Don't Speak by No Doubt. Perfect Day cover was good. I actually really like the Puff Daddy one, I'll Be Missing You. But Candle in the Wind is a bit of a travesty in retrospect. Not the original. The original's fantastic. But redone one.
What's quite interesting, Elton John said he would never ever play that version again. It was like a one-off. In fact, I think it was a lot for him to play it at the funeral. But he actually said he would never play it again, and he doesn't want it on any compilation albums and stuff. He just
and the world thanks him.
Okay, so I'm going to move on to the top 10 best-selling albums of 1997 in the UK.
Oh, man, you scored, sorry. Okay, sorry.
Number 10, bear in mind this is 1997, The 10th best-selling album of that year was The Best of Wham.
Wow.
Greatest Hits by Eternal. At number 8...
Can I just interject? Sorry, I'm really sorry to interrupt, but is The Greatest Hits of Eternal, two songs on it or something?
Greatest Hit.
On 7-inch.
Yeah. So at number 8, we've got a classic, OK Computer by Radiohead.
Yep.
At number 7, Let's Talk About Love by Celine Dion. At number 6, The Fat of the Land by The Prodigy. At number 5, White on Blonde by Texas. At number 4, Spice World by The Spice Girls. At number 3, Spice by The Spice Girls. At number 2, Urban Hymns by The Verve. And number 1, Be Here Now by Oasis. And that's a big favourite of yours, Paul.
Oh, yes. Yes. There's another arc to every album that they brought out. Honestly, it's as good as What's the Story, Morning Glory. Yeah. Last one was rubbish.
I think it sold quickly, didn't it? It sold... Mm-hmm. I think there was like a big pre-sale. People were queuing to buy it and everything, but then when they got it, it was like real disappointment. But that's why the sales were so good, because there was so much anticipation. But unfortunately, in my opinion anyway, it was a big letdown.
You know, that would be a really good album to do an episode for Trimming the Musical Fat.
It sounds like it would be, yeah.
Oh, guess what we're recording in June. Yes, we would. Yeah, actually, let me tell you, we are going to do that album. I think we've got it due to record in June, and when you go to the expanded edition where you've got other versions of the tracks and the B-sides and so on, that is actually a really good album in there. You just need to go and look for it. So yeah, I'm actually really looking forward to doing that.
Hidden in all the cocaine somewhere.
Yeah.
The layers of guitars and cocaine.
But looking at that, those albums there, I think I owned over half of them.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's
quite funny, the Spice Girls being 4 and 3. That's right.
But yeah, Prodigy is great. A great album, Radiohead. Another great album there as well. Some good stuff
they
in
still,
there.
Yeah, well, they still stand up now, you know, when you look back, you know.
Again, sort of for Flaming Pie, and it was like, obviously, Flaming Pie is much more of a stripped back album, and it felt like, again, it was maybe just a little bit too late, like how Britpop, sort of like indie music, had well produced by 90s. They're about Urban Hymns and even Be Here Now. Like, lots of like layers on it, orchestration and stuff. And if you'd released it a couple of years beforehand, Flaming Pie probably sounded a bit more along the lines of what else was coming. You know, because it was like, I think that was probably the peak 97 of budget on indie music, you know, see the production values of it all.
Okay, so I'm going to move on to the top 10 grossing movies in the UK in that year of 1997. So at number 10, Liar Liar. At number 9, Tomorrow Never Dies. At number 8, Jerry Maguire. At number 7, Batman and... At number 6, Bean. At number 5, Ransom. Give me back my son. At number 4, Star Wars A New Hope Special Edition. At number 3, Lost World Jurassic Park. At number 2, Men in Black. At number 1, it's those men from Sheffield, the Phil Monty.
I'm surprised Tomorrow Never Dies is quite low.
It only came out in November, so that would have only have had about 6 or 7 weeks.
Yeah.
So yeah, it would have been higher, I think, if the complete gross of it as it went into 98.
It should have beat Mr. Bean, surely, though, you would have thought.
Ah, but Bean might have been out for months and months. Never know. Mm-hmm. Batman and Robin. I mean, there are some great movies. I mean, I'm a big fan of the Bond movie, Tomorrow Never Dies. Jerry Maguire, just watched that again recently. It's a fantastic movie. Ransom's really good. Star Wars A New Hope, one of my favourite films. Yeah. And I think The Full Monty... The Full Monty was just one of those films that was in the right place at the right time, because that just come out after Princess Diana had died? And I think it was one of those where people were just looking for something a bit lighthearted and funny, and that movie came out and just had legs, had legs and everything else, but it just kept making money, didn't it?
I think the audience, I think Britain at that point was just desperate to see Sean Bean's That's what it was. Well, the bit lighthearted belief.
I did not already see it in GoldenEye.
I think they'd seen it many a time, to be fair.
Lady Chatterley's Lover, I think it was in that as well.
Yeah, I'm sure it's written into, at that point in his life, it was written into his contract. I heard he was gutted he couldn't do it in a Bond film, GoldenEye. Yeah. Check this out, James.
For England, James.
Put it away, Sean.
I could be wrong, Stephen, but I think Phil Monty came out before Princess Diana died. I don't know 100%, but I think. But maybe after she died, maybe that was something that people went to or something.
Yeah, I just seem to remember that from the
Mr. Bean. That's what they wanted. They wanted to see Mr. Bean.
Sean Bean.
They came out very disappointed.
It's all the beans, isn't it? Getting their beans out.
Okay, so I'll move on to the three stories, a few news stories that happened that year. So scientists at the Roslin Institute announced the birth of a clone sheep named Dolly 7 months after the fact. Do you remember that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember that, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Dolly's in the Museum of Scotland.
Mm.
Just down the road.
Wonder if she called herself.
You've got to be careful, and I think they were going to take it to some places up north of Scotland, but they were worried it might get abused, so had to put it out of...
yeah, keep it in the further south. Yeah.
No, were they not going to put her? Were they not going to put her at the Parliament? Dollywood? No.
I think they were going to put her beside her sister in mixture.
And actually, in Paul's neck of the woods in Dundee. Grand Theft Auto was developed by DME Design and was launched in Dundee in the year 1997.
Grand Theft Auto.
And I think Grand Theft Auto is just about the biggest gaming franchise in the world, isn't it?
Yeah, it is now.
I've still never got around to playing the fifth one. I've had that lying around for years to play. Still haven't got to. Because I know if I want to complete it, it's going to take about 40 hours of my life, which is why I keep putting it to the bottom of the pile.
And lastly, other news story that year, Scots vote in the creation of a national parliament with devolved powers, with limited tax-raising powers. So that was the Scottish Parliament, which 2 years later was built after a lot of money and delay, a bit like the trams, but we finally got it in 1999, and that was when it was voted in 97. And that's all the top news stories for the year.
It's time to trim the talk, where we are all asked the same question and have to answer in alphabetical order. However, we only have 3 minutes to do this. So, gentlemen, are you ready?
Yes.
Yeah.
Cool. So we're going to answer in alphabetical order. So it'll be Paul Murphy, Paul Nicholson, and then myself. And our 3 minutes start now.
3 minutes start now.
So describe Paul McCartney in 3 words.
Fab, gear, maca.
Genius, legend, hopeful.
Thumbs aloft, maca. Have you seen Paul McCartney live?
No, but my mum has.
Your mum's seen everybody, Paul, live, hasn't
she? Yeah.
Guns N' Roses as well.
1975.
Oh, brilliant. Cool. Right, let's move on. Time limit.
Yep, and we obviously, Stephen and I and my dad, we saw him at Hampden in 2010 and the Glasgow Hydro in 2018.
Yep, two great concerts.
Yeah.
Okay, favourite Paul McCartney solo album?
Ram.
Ram also.
Oh, I might go Band on the Run. Favourite Paul McCartney.
No wings.
Of course not. Oh, yes, that's right. I will therefore go.
Press to play.
I will go. Certainly won't be Press to Play. I would maybe go then with his debut.
2 minutes left.
Favourite Paul McCartney song. No Wings.
No More Lonely Nights. No More Lonely Nights.
Maybe I'm Amazed.
I would also go with Maybe I'm Amazed. What were you doing at the time of the album release, May 1997?
Probably playing with myself.
Okay. Nothing new there then. Paul Nicholson?
I think I'd started working at Queen Margaret in January of that year. And I think in May, it was when the general election was around that year, of course. So there was a lot of optimism at the time, which was probably unfounded, but there you go.
Okay, for me, yeah, I'd be working in the bank. I'm probably looking forward to a good holiday. In fact, I'm sure that was when I was due to go down for a long weekend in Liverpool, so I was going to take in a lot of the things like the Cavern and such like, so yeah, that would be right.
1 minute remaining.
So when and where did you first hear Flaming Pie?
I think what the day of release, I remember I bought the CD out of, I think, HMV.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think similarly for me, the day of release on the Monday it came out.
Yep, yeah. Same for me. Yep, probably would have listened to it when I got home from work. Mm-hmm. Favourite track on the album?
The song we were singing.
Souvenir.
30 seconds to go.
Beautiful night for me. Your least favourite track on the album?
Flaming Pie.
Boo. Used to be bad.
Really love you. And your album rating out of 5 in its current incarnation?
Current incarnation 2.
4.
I would go 4. So anybody know any good Paul McCartney jokes before we start to look at the album itself. So, Paul Murphy, I'll maybe start with you.
There's the old one of, what do you call a pig with wings? But I'm not going to say that. there's the other one of, what would it take for, well, this was 20 odd years ago when the album came. What would it take for another Beatles reunion? Three bullets. but apart from that, that's about it. I'm sure there was a bit of, what was it that Paul McCartney liked to do with Heather? Heather Mills, a bit of a rumpy stumpy, wasn't it?
yeah.
I think I've taken all your jokes, Paul, but yeah.
Yeah, you got any, Paul?
Well, yeah, did you hear Macca was disqualified from London Marathon? He was banned on the run.
I've actually got a few of the more nastier variety. All
I know, I saw him last night.
Yeah, coming from his split from Heather Mills, which was what, about 15 years ago. The split up, would that be right?
Yeah, roughly. Yeah,
that long ago. Yeah,
yeah. So
2006.
So let me give you a couple of these examples that I found online. So here we go. Paul McCartney dedicated a few songs last night, which I thought was nice. He sang songs for his pals George Harrison and John Lennon, then dedicated My Love to Linda. But the song that brought a tear to my eye was a new one he dedicated to Heather called Die You Money Hungry Selfish Bitch. Right, and yeah, another one. Paul McCartney and Heather Mills are splitting up. Sources say McCartney will walk away with most of his fortune, while Mills will hop away with an autographed copy of Wings' greatest hits and a Yoko Ono dartboard. Oh dear. Oh, just nasty. Okay, it's now time for the segment where we get a teenager to listen to an album for the first time. So we call it Hey Generation Z, this is what real music sounds like. This is going to be a very quick edition of Hey Generation Z, this is what real music sounds like, because you're getting ready to go to school. Mm-hmm. So you listen to Paul McCartney's Flaming Pie, and we'll talk about it in a second, but as a 13-year-old, nearly 14, what do you know about Paul McCartney?
He was in the Beatles, and he is one of the two that are still alive right now.
Yeah. And what Paul McCartney's solo songs do you know?
I don't really know any. I only know ones from like the Beatles.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
So not really any solo stuff.
No, because I always thought he wouldn't be as good.
Okay.
As when he was in the Beatles.
Okay. And what age is Paul McCartney, do you reckon?
Isn't he in his 70s or something now?
Yes, he is. Okay. So you listened to Flaming Pie. What did you think of it?
I thought it was better than I thought it was going to be, because I thought it was probably going to be just quite acoustic and stuff like that. And I don't really like that, but it was better than I thought it was.
Okay. So you're saying, I think the last album you had to listen to was Metallica's and Justice for All. So yeah, I think you're quite comfortably saying you enjoyed this much more.
Yeah, just because it was just way better than I thought it was going to be.
Okay, and was there any song that you liked best?
I think, what was the first one called again?
The song we were singing?
Yeah, I think I liked that one the most. I just thought that was the one I enjoyed over all of them.
Yeah, what did you like about that one?
I just liked the words and how it went from like slow and then to really fast.
Mm-hmm, yeah,
I liked that.
Kind of rousing chorus.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Well, Luke, thank you very much for listening to it.
You're welcome.
Enjoy school.
Okay.
It's Friday, so
yeah,
only a half day.
Half day.
So it's time to catch up with the band on the run and trim the fat. For this first selection, we're including all the songs that featured on the 2020 remastered deluxe version of the album. So before we get to the tracks itself, let's perhaps talk about the album cover. So Paul Murphy, what's your, you got any thoughts on the design of the album cover, the artwork and such like?
It just seemed a bit, you know, like, I mean, now looking at it, it seems a bit cheap, really. I mean, I know that it's a Linda McCartney photo. It was, it's not as cheap as the follow-up album, which looked like it was taken on a Game Boy camera.
Was it not a watch?
Oh, it was a watch.
A watch,
yeah.
Or something. Yeah. 10p cover. Yeah.
Yeah, I feel. Yeah, it's a bit kind of, I don't know. Yeah, it doesn't really stand out. You know, you compare it to like maybe some of his other classic albums, or even like kind of iconic in a way. You know, even Venus and Mars, it looks interesting. I think this is, yeah, it's kind of just like a bit of a bleh.
What about you, Paul?
I quite like the cover, actually. I don't know, I just feel it reflects the time. What's quite interesting in some of the artwork inside is some of the photos are from like a couple of years previously when he's still got his mullet.
Mm. Yeah.
Like some who's got his hair short in 97, but like there's photos there. I'm sure they're from like 94, 95, because a lot of their songs were recorded then. I quite like it. I think what's quite poignant about the album cover as well, because obviously it was Linda was dying at that time, and so it's quite poignant, some of it as well, and her last obviously input on any of his albums as well. So
I splashed the cash to get the double vinyl reissue of this. Which is nuts. I think it cost me £40, which is just stupid money. But it is very plush, I have to say. But there's nothing striking about it from my perspective. Yeah, it's all right. Nothing really special. Okay, so that is the album cover. We're now going to talk about the songs that are definitely making it on to this. So these are the songs. Oh God, Man United are now 2-1 down. God. Okay, it's all going wrong. We'll talk about the songs that are unanimously we've agreed will be on the album. So there was 9 songs we all agreed should be on there. So the first one was the song that we were singing. So let's have a quick listen to that.
But we always came back to the song we were singing at any particular time. Yeah, we always came back to the song we were singing at any particular time.
Alrighty, so Paul Murphy, what's your thoughts on this one? We already know it's your favourite on the album.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a fairly decent song. It's a good intro. It's a good intro to the album. I think with the song itself, it kind of maybe, you know, overall feelings for the album is that, I mean, I think the production on it isn't brilliant. I think his vocals begin to sound a bit like, I don't think the recording of his vocals does his voice much justice, really. But you know, it's a good intro. Maybe goes on a little bit. I think it's a pleasant enough intro to the album. It's quite a good way to get started.
Okay. Brother Paul?
Yeah, I think it's a good song. It's not a great song, it's a good song. And that was written in January 95, I think. So the first one he did, taped with Jeff Lynne, he's a producer. And I think it's a good song, but it kind of reminds me of Big Barn Bed on Red Rose Speedway, the opening track on that album, where it sort of goes slow and then it builds up, and by the time it gets to the end of the song, the sound's really been elevated from quite a small start. So yeah, that's what I... What about you? What do you think about it?
Yeah, for me, it is... yeah, it's a good song. I like it. It's got a real all-round, the kind of campfire feel about it. It's very rousing. It's got a nice stomping chorus. And I like some of the kind of twanging background guitar that goes on in it as well. So yeah, no, it's a good song. And I've got a couple of interesting facts here for you. Paul McCartney plays a stand-up bass on it that was originally owned by Bill Black and used on Elvis's early hits, including Heartbreak Hotel. So there we go. There's your bit of musical history there. So yeah, song. Yeah,
I think Linda bought that for him, didn't she? I think for his birthday or something.
Yeah, I think she's seen it. Jumbo sailed £15.
Yeah, church jumbo sale.
Okay, so the song we were singing makes the cut. Second song that makes it on to our supercut is The World Tonight. Alrighty, Brother Paul, let's start with you this time.
I think it had the makings of a good song, because I remember when I watched the documentary at the time. In fact, I think it was called The World Tonight as well, the documentary. And I think he said, oh, Linda was saying to me, I like it when you do those heavy songs, Paul, on the guitar. But for me, it sounds a bit lightweight. What I would probably have liked to have done with the song was slowed it down and made the guitar, the riff heavier, a bit like Old Woman Oh Why. That's what I would have done with the song, like slowed it down and make the guitar a bit more distorted, and then I think you would have had a great song. I've always thought that about that song.
Old Woman Oh Why, I've not heard that in years. That's a brilliant song. That was the B-side to...
Another day,
yeah. That's right, let's give that a listen, actually. That's a great tune. Thanks, Paul. That's Paul good. Murphy.
I mean, I agree with Paul on it. I think a lot with going back to this album, as I might sort of talk through going through each of the songs, it feels like a demo. It's not quite, you know, it doesn't quite go to the next level. It feels a bit too Jeff Lynne produced as well. The drums, quite heavy. It feels like it's just not quite, you know, it's like an 8 instead of a 10. It feels like it just needs to turn it up a notch a little bit. Yeah, so it's okay. I mean, but yeah, not brilliant. It felt like it needed a lot more work. A lot of this album, as I'll probably talk through it a lot about, is it felt a bit underbaked for a pie.
Okay, yes. Well, you've mentioned production. Let's talk about that. Obviously, the album did have different producers. What do you think? What impact did that have on the album? And do you feel it sounds as one, or do you feel you can hear the joins in it from the different producers? I mean, stick with you, Paul Murphy.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds to me, you can tell it's three different... It's mainly three sessions, isn't it? So there's one with Jeff Lynne, one with Steve Miller, and then there was another session which I think George Martin got involved with, and it sounds like it's... So for me, the big difference between this and Tug of War, which, you know, rightly or wrongly, sounds of its time, but it's like the production value, it sounds consistent as an album, whereas this doesn't really sound that consistent. It sounds like it's just been, which I know a story behind it was a bit of it, but it sounds like he's, at times he's just recorded, he's had some demo sessions set up at his home studio. He's got Jeff Lynne in for one session, flown out to America with Steve Miller to do another. So it doesn't quite have a consistent order. I think you notice that most with Youngboy, that sounds completely different compared to the rest of the album, just the way it's produced and stuff. So I don't think it really works for me. I think it would have been better if he just stuck with Jeff Lynne for everything, or with himself, or... I think if he'd taken the whole album to somebody else and gone, right, let's make a proper album out of it that would have
Phil sounded Spector.
Better. Well, they worked to get through the recording alive, didn't they? Yeah, what would you think, Paul?
I like the sound of the... I like the production. I mean, it's obvious what the Jeff Lynne tracks are because of the drums and the acoustics high in the mix. It's always, you always know that's Jeff Lynne, but I don't know, I quite like it because I felt at this time, because in the early 90s, probably when Off the Ground came out, for me, there was still a sort of hangover from the 80s in terms of the keyboard sound and stuff. Whereas it felt like with this album, we finally got away from that Casio keyboard 80s sound. And so yeah, I think it's quite good. Really, I think the sound, yeah.
Well, I was just going to say, like, for me, I think this is the first album where Paul McCartney no longer bothered to try and sound contemporary anymore. It was just like he was now going out to sound like the 60s, 70s, whereas mm-hmm. even going back listening to Off the Ground, I mean, it doesn't have great production. It sounds really early 90s, which is a strange sound because it's like, I never thought that had a sound of the early 90s, sort of like rock CD sound, but it does. Mm-hmm. It's very distinct of that era. And likewise, you know, Flowers in the Dark sounds very, very late 80s. Whereas this, it's like he's not even trying to be contemporary. It's like, no, I'm just going to, you know, like, I'm going to use old equipment now. I'm going to record with the Hofner bass, which he'd never really done that much before. He'd always used more modern equipment and stuff. And, it, you know, I think on one hand, it is quite refreshing that, you know, he's done it, but it feels like he's never got out of that rut, really. You know, he's always just stuck with, you know, like, and it's not that contemporary, the recordings that he makes now. It's all kind of the, he'll go, oh, here's the Mellotone that I played on Strawberry Fields, which I think was the first time he did this.
That's right, yeah.
It's like every album, it's like, here's the Mellotone I did on Strawberry Fields.
That's right. When he's trying to promote his latest album, he brings out the stories.
Yeah. I think, but with actually this one, this was the first album that he did that really with.
Yeah, but I actually think in terms of this album and music at the time, I remember at the time, because you tend to find that the decade previous gets a lot of stick. And I think at that time, what I liked about this, it was kind of distances in itself from the 80s because, and I think a lot of the artists were then as well, there was a real backlash to the 80s because it was quite recent in terms of, whereas in the mid 90s, you got a lot of bands that were actually playing their instruments again, as opposed to just doing it on a Casio keyboard.
I think for me with... Yeah. Sorry, on you go, Paul.
No, you go. On you go.
No, I was going to say, I think for me at the time when the album came out, I probably did not see the joins then there and felt it was very consistent. And it's only been revisiting it for this the Jeff Lynne stuff, a lot of that you've got, yep. I think you can hear, like, you know, what the stuff that he did with the Traveling Wilburys and Tom Petty and so on. I think that becomes more, it was more pronounced to me. But still didn't take away from my enjoyment of the album. But I think I'm looking for it now and you're like, yeah, that's obviously George Martin, that's obviously Jeff Lynne on that one and so on. But hey-ho. My thoughts on the song itself, so I Can See the World Tonight. Obviously, that was the second single. It has a very Beatlesque opening riff, which resurfaces again a few times in the song, which is really nice. I really like it. It's got a real purpose to it, nice guitar riff. And yeah, that one has a very Jeff Lynne sounding production when I've obviously revisited it. But yeah, good song, like it.
Big budget video as well.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
It's like it looks like it's Spain or something, and they've got this big umbrella and it keeps on twirling it around.
Yeah, it certainly wasn't filmed in Liverpool, that's for sure. Somewhere nice and warm. Okay, the third song that makes our cut is Sundays.
It's no good asking me what time of day it is. Who won the match or scored the goal? Some days I look. Some days I look into your soul.
So that's Sundays. Paul Murphy, what's your thoughts on this one?
You know, I think it's a nice enough song, but I think, again, you know, like going back to McCartney's other stuff, so I think it's been a good exercise, this, just listening. So one thing that struck me with this was that, you know, with Here Today on Tug of War, it's sort of a similar song. Type of song, but if you listen to the difference between them, like Here Today sounds really lush in its production and the orchestration, and whereas this sounds like, again, it's, I mean, I understand it's been recorded in McCartney's home studio, but it just, it doesn't have the production value. And I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's just the how it's been produced, how it's been recorded, but it just doesn't sound anywhere near as good as Here Today, which has a really, really lovely, you know, lush sound to it. So in a way, I think, yeah, it's good. It's raw, but again, it feels like a demo to me. It feels like it, you know, needed something bigger, maybe like that video. We're talking about, need a bit more money spent on it. I don't know.
Yeah, well, it was obviously produced by McCartney, and George Martin did the orchestration on it, so he didn't produce it.
Yeah, but
Paul, brother Paul,
I think it's a good song, but yeah, I think Paul's right about, you know, when you compare it to Here Today of Tug of War, this feels quite loud, you know, and there's no, whereas Here Today, if you're comparing, it was quite delicate and vulnerable, where this almost sounds like it's live, almost. It's quite loud, almost like it's live.
Okay.
But yeah.
Yeah. Well, this is one of those ones where you're right. I think Paul McCartney had said, I'd driven Linda to a photo shoot for one of her cookery assignments. Knowing she'd be about 2 hours, I set myself a deadline to write a song. And obviously, that's what he came up with. And the song itself, I mean, you're talking about it being like a demo. It was recorded in one take. But McCartney felt it could be enhanced a bit, which is why George Martin had to do an orchestral score over the song, which was a good thing in my book. I love the orchestration on it. Obviously, it was originally just going to be acoustic only, but I think the orchestration raises it up several levels, makes it very Beatley, especially the chorus. I mean, some of it actually sounds very Eleanor Rigby-like. Obviously, not reaching anywhere near the heights of Eleanor Rigby, but it does somewhat sound similar in certain parts of it. Okay, so Sundays makes it onto our cut. The next one that makes it on there is the first single from the album, and that was the one featuring Steve Miller, and that is Young Boy. He's got to do it for himself. Alrighty, brother Paul.
It's one of my favourites on the album, actually. I think it's a great song. It's, I remember the first time I heard it, I think it was maybe on Radio 1 or something, and managed to get my cassette in to get maybe the last half of the song, because this was Paul McCartney's new single. And I think for me it was quite significant because, excuse me, around that, in the previous years I'd bought all the Paul McCartney albums to date. So it was kind of like this was the first new single since I had his whole collection. So it was quite exciting as well. And I think it's a really good song, and it sounds, I really like the sound. I know it wasn't a big hit, but no, I think it's a really good, really catchy song. Reminds me like of Another Day or something.
Yeah, for me, I'm looking at the notes here. This was another one written against the clock. I think this time Linda was cooking lunch for a feature in the New York Times. I like it. I like the song. It's obviously the first single. It's a nice welcome change of pace. It's got a really nice guitar opening there. I think it's actually, on going back to it, it reminds me of Hope of Deliverance, which was obviously the first single from the previous album. Another thing, which on revisiting it, is it does sound very Jeff Lynne, very ELO sounding, especially the background vocals, which I never really picked up on before. But yeah, great pop song. And yeah, there's some nice guitar in it by Steve Miller. What about you, Paul?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a good, you know, it's a really good song. Is it a single? Probably not. Maybe again. I mean, it kind of sounds like I'm like really coming down on it, but it sort of highlights again. This was now getting into the year when McCartney couldn't write hit singles anymore, or like pop songs, catchy pop songs. So I think it is a good song, but as a lead single, I'm, you know, probably not quite strong enough. But yeah, good song. But yeah, this is now, you know, like the days of McCartney writing top 10 songs are, you know, are gone now. I think that's the thing. It's quite sad about this album in a way, because it's sort of like the sign of things to come with them, where, oh, actually, you know, those hit singles aren't going to come back. But overall, as a song, I think it is quite nice. It's a bit of an you know, I don't think it really gets much love now, really, as a song. So, a bit of a forgotten gem.
Okay, thank you for that. So let's move on to our fifth track that's making it on. And that is the song Calico Skies.
My eyes, and the morning when I first saw you gave me life under calico skies. I will hold you for as long as you like. I'll hold you for the rest of my life.
Alrighty, that was Calico Sky. So, Paul Murphy, what's your thoughts on this one?
Yeah, I think it's a nice little Beatles-esque number. I mean, I think it works quite well overall, because it is just, it's quite basic. So I think that does work quite well. You don't need a huge amount of production on this. But I think it was recorded in, was that recorded in 1992, this one? Is this not the first one?
It was August 91, the genesis of it, yep.
It was actually recorded in September 92, yeah.
So that would have been, I mean, I don't know if that must have been just after the Off the Ground session.
Yeah, just after it was released, yeah.
So, I like it. I think it's a good song.
Paul?
I think it's a beautiful song, actually. I think it's one of the highlights for me. I remember seeing the video on the World Tonight documentary where he's sitting there playing along with it. He's got these terrible dungarees on. I remember that in the video. And but it's a really lovely song. And actually, I had a person I used to work with, she got this played at her wedding, this song. But it reminds me of like the White Album, you know, like the finger picking of Blackbird and Mother Nature's Son. It reminds me of that era. And I think it's one of the few songs that he still plays live, actually, from this album, you know, to his recent years. Yeah. What about you?
I think this was obviously co-produced between Paul McCartney and George Martin, and yeah, no, I love this song. I think it's great, similar to you, Paul. I think it's a beautiful song, could have been on the White Album. It's earnest, honest, and heartfelt. And actually, whenever I hear it, actually, we know obviously Linda McCartney. When was it recorded? It was 92, but bizarrely, whenever I hear it now, I always think this is what Paul McCartney would be singing to Linda as she's passing away. Because it's just all very apt, isn't it? The lyrics and the feel of the song, you know, I'll hold you as long as you like. So, yeah, no, I love this song. Short as well. Yep, great tune.
Yeah, beautiful.
Okay, that is our fifth track. Our next one's another great song, and that is Souvenir.
When you're fed up, shedding too many tears, seem like just so many souvenirs. I will come to you to ease the pain. If you want me, tell me now. If I can be of any help, tell me how. Let me love you like a friend.
Alrighty, Paul Nicholson, what's your thoughts on Souvenir?
Yeah, it was my favourite track on the album, actually. It's just a really good song, and having, you know, just previously to this album coming out, collected all the albums, this sounded like something from Venus and Mars or something. And it reminded me of Marlin or Call Me Back Again, that sort of, and I love those sort of soulful songs that Paul McCartney does. So, and the funny thing about this song as well is there was this rumour going for a long time that Brian May and Roger Taylor were going to do a cover of it for like a Paul McCartney tribute album.
Hmm.
It was one of these rumours that was going for a long time about Once Upon a Long Ago, Freddie was going to be invited to do that as a duet, apparently. It's all these things you find out. Yeah, yeah. Years later, yeah. But obviously at the time, I think he was doing Barcelona. But yeah, great song. Hmm. Excellent.
Okay, Paul Murphy?
Yeah, it's a... It works well with the production on it as well. I think it was Jeff Lynne also co-produced this.
Yeah, which is surprising, isn't it?
Yeah, it doesn't sound like it. Too Jeff Lynne-y. No. So yeah, I think it's good. It sounds raw. I think it's it works really well. It's a great song.
Yeah, same for me. I think that's what Paul was saying there. It sounds like 70s McCartney. Crossed with kind of classic 60s R&B sound. Love the song. Great chorus, especially when the backing vocals come in as the song progresses. I think there's a nice saxophone on it as well. And the outro, like all the crackly static and so on, which they carried over from the demo of it, from A Tropical Storm. They carried it over, yeah. So, great tune. Great tune on there. Okay, we move on to, in fact, we're all the good stuff now. We're moving on to another one, and this is Little Willow.
Bend, little willow, wind's gonna blow you hot and cold tonight. Life as it happens, nobody warns you, willow, hold on tight. Nothing's gone.
Okay, Little Willow, Paul, Brother Paul.
Yeah, I think it's a good song, it's a decent song. It's, and I know the sentiment behind it because it's about Maureen Starkey, isn't it? You know, about her passing away cancer.
Yep.
It's about her.
Yep, written after Paul learned of the death of a dear friend. Yep.
Yeah, but it's a bit lightweight, I feel. I don't know.
How dare you?
It's a bit lightweight.
Okay,
but,
Paul.
But it's a good song. But...
All right, Paul Murphy, do you want to take him to task on it?
I would agree. I think it's...
Get out.
It's good, I man. Think it's one of those songs that I think feels like it needs to be elevated. It's quite basic in chord structure, the lyrics. And I think with a bit of better oomph behind it in terms of production, it could turn it into a really good song. Feels a bit too Jeff Lynne as well with the backing vocals and stuff. It's one of those difficult ones. Going back to, I loved it when it came out, like I loved the album when it came out, but going back to it's like it just feels like it's a bit of a wasted opportunity. It could have been an amazing song instead of it's kind of it's good, and I think that's the thing, it could have been brilliant, but needed just a bit more baking in that oven.
Okay, well, I respectfully disagree, and I think it was put in the oven just with the right ingredients for the right amount of time to be tasting perfect. I think it's a beautiful, heartfelt acoustic song. This time, some nice piano on it. I actually think it sounds like early 80s sounding Paul McCartney, something like Waterfall. Something like that, something that would be on Tug of War, McCartney II, something like that, and another short song as well. So, big Maca thumbs up from me for that one. Alrighty, we're moving into our eighth song of the nine that is making it, and we go to this time the penultimate song that was on the album. So we've got Beautiful Night, and I think we'll play this from around about the chorus. Here we go. Beautiful Night, Paul Murphy.
I think it's a decent song. Again, it's another one that I think feels like it. I know it was an old song that he went back to. Was it 86? I think it was originally.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Recorded for, but again, listening to it, so again, I loved it when it was released. I thought, oh, it sounds just like the Beatles when it's released. Now listen, it feels a bit like somebody trying to copy the Beatles. Like the end sounds a bit like the end, and it's like it just feels a bit forced. I think underneath it there could be an amazing song, but again the production just kind of lets it down. It sounds like it's, you know, and I don't know if it's just the difference between his Hog Hill Mill or whatever it is studio, and you know, something like this had been recorded at Abbey Road, would it feel a bit different? Would it feel bigger? I don't know. So. Yeah, I loved it at the time. I listened back to it and think, oh, it's a bit of a missed opportunity because it could be amazing, but it's fairly good.
Well, I think for me, I remember when I first listened to it, the biggest thing for me was it was like, hooray, a piano-led song, because this is the only one on the album. It's a very guitar-driven album, this one. So this is the first time you had a piano to the fore, so... Yeah, I loved it then. I love it now. It's my favourite on the album. And it's got a great chorus. I think you're right, Paul. It does sound like, you know, the Golden Slumbers, the end from Abbey Road. Very, very similar in its makeup. It's got Ringo on drums as well. It's got a lovely George Martin orchestration. So, yeah, big thumbs up for me. And I like the speeded up outro to the song as well. Paul?
Yeah, I kind of agree with what you're both saying. I really loved it at the time, and it did remind me of Abbey Road. What I really loved was in the documentary, The World Tonight, when you see him playing the guitar solo to it, it's only fleeting, it's like 5 seconds, and it's just amazing. It reminds me of like Carry That Weight. And it's one of these songs, you know, years ago when they released singles off albums, I actually preferred it when it was an album track. And then when it became a single, I didn't like it as much. It's funny, sometimes it can work both ways. And for me, I kind of, and now when I listen to it, it's maybe not as good as I remember. And I have to say, I enjoyed the original version because you got that on one of the CD singles from 86. I mean, it's very of its time, very 80s sounding, but there's a really good song in there. And I just think Ringo's annoying at the end. Now, you know.
You think so?
Yeah, I just think he's annoying, yeah.
All right.
I just think he ruins it.
He just phoned me to tell he just phoned me to say that you annoy him. So there you go, you're even.
Peace and love.
Peace and love.
I'm not doing any autographs. Peace
you're
and
annoying,
love.
You're annoying, Paul. Yeah. So mixed from you two guys, a big thumbs up from me. So that brings us to the final song we unanimously agree is going to make it, which is Great Day.
When you're wide awake, say it for goodness sake, it's gonna be a great day. While you stand.
Brother Paul.
Yeah, I really like it. It's just a basic little song, but it just like we were talking about Beautiful Night being like the sort of Abbey Road medley, this is almost like Your Majesty, you know, because it's like you would think that, you know, you would end on this big massive like anthemic song like Beautiful Night and like on Abbey Road, you know, with the medley, and then he brings in this little acoustic number just as a little just a gentle thing at the end just to finish it off, and it reminds me of that. I think it's a really good song. Mm-hmm. It's basic, but I think that's what's good about it.
I think for me it was and again this is just coming back to it, listening to the album again for doing this, and what struck me was I was like, oh, that really likes sounds like something that could have been on his debut, you know. It's really very early exactly 70s. Then I read that it was actually written in the early 70s, so that would be why. And he just kind of unearthed it and recorded it. So, but yeah, it's a nice little simple acoustic tune, no more, no less. And like you, I think it's just like Her Majesty from the end of Abbey Road, just this little bonus extra acoustic type thing to finish the album. What about you, Paul?
I mean, I've got it on my thing. I think it, I mean, I would cut it down at 60 seconds. I mean, it sounds like... what was going to become Big Barn Bed, but when it was Who's That Coming Around That Corner from the end of Admiral Halsey, very, very similar structure to it. Also sounds a bit like when you used to see those clips of him doing, was it Bip Bop?
Bip Bop.
Early 70s.
But the difference is like, you know, those wouldn't have been 2 minutes long on Wings or Ram or even Her Majesty at the end.
It would have been 6 minutes.
Yeah, it would have been like 30 seconds or something. But this, it's like 2 minutes long, and it doesn't need to be that long. It could be a nice little 60 seconds, get it over and done with, nice little thing, get it out. So it just goes on a bit, maybe overstays its welcome, which I think a lot of the songs on this album do.
Okay, thank you for that. So we've got our 9 songs that have made it. We have a spot for one more, and we're going to very shortly discuss what that final song will be. But before it, there were 2 songs that all 3 of us did not want on the album. And let's listen to let's listen to the first of them, which was Used to Be Bad. That used to be bad.
Used to be good.
We don't need to hear any more of that one. I'll maybe kick us off with this. So obviously it's a blues jam type song which goes on for perhaps 4 minutes too long, which is a shame since the runtime of it is 4 minutes 12 seconds. Totally unremarkable. It should have been a bonus track or a B-side or even better, unreleased. So, my new equalise. Go on, Cavani. To give it some credit, there is a nice guitar solo on it, which I think is played by Steve Miller. I just don't think much of it. What about you, Paul Murphy?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's... the album is, 55 minutes for the original runtime? It doesn't need to be on it. Again, it's sort of like typical, I think, of, you know, McCartney by this point, of sticking songs on when, like, we're doing this podcast, you know, like if he cut out some of the songs, he would have a much better need for it to be on there. It would have been great as a B-side, you know what I mean? And not as a single on, not as a song on an album.
Yeah, Paul.
Yeah, I just think it's just filler, really, isn't it? It's the reason why we do this podcast in many ways. For songs like this, it's just like, why put that on when there's so many great songs? It's almost like, because he'd done a couple with Steve Miller, his old mate, I'll put a couple of songs on with you, Steve, but they're just boring. You know, they're almost like sound checks or something.
Yeah, and so we've got another one with Steve Miller, so he's not coming out of this too well, is he?
Poor Steve Miller.
Poor Steve Miller. I know he is. He's a great guitarist, I know. Yeah. So the other one that we're dropping is Really Love You. So let's, I think Ringo plays drums on this one too. So let's just hear a bit of it. Enough of that one. So for me, for this one, it's another kind of blues jam similar to Used to Be Bad, and it, for me, it just goes nowhere. I just find it boring, and you know, I'm just reaching for my scissors to cut it from the album. What about you, Brother Paul?
Yeah, it's just like, does he really think, because what was great about this time was that it was almost like his credibility, and he kind of got his confidence back, and he wasn't ashamed of his Beatles past, and he was embracing it. So why does he do this song? It's like, is it the arrogance that you think you can just put anything on? It's like, yeah, why put this on? It's just rubbish.
Okay. Paul?
Yeah, it's Jeff Lynne, not Steve Miller on this one.
So well, is it really?
Steve's been saved on this. So, yeah, this was...
apologies this to Steve if he's listening.
yeah, it's McCartney, Jeff Lynne and Ringo on drums, and this is the first song that's a Paul McCartney Ringo Starr co-written song, isn't it?
That's right, yeah.
It feels like with a lot of this, he's trying too hard to try and capture something, and trying to capture the essence of the Beatles or whatever. And you know, if you compare someone like Helter Skelter, which you know is pretty meaningless as a song, there's not much structure. Difference is the night and day between this and I Really Love You and Helter Skelter. It just doesn't go anywhere. It feels a bit turgid. It's, yeah, I mean, why it's on it, maybe because it's like a McCartney Starr composition, but it's 5 minutes. It's 5 minutes that you just don't need to have on it. And it, you know, sums up, like, he'd maybe lost a bit of the edge where there's, like, loads of songs, like, you know, like... Like we're talking about Old Woman O'Why, which is a brilliant song. And that's a similar sort of just kind of like a bit of a jam type song. And this doesn't even come close to that. It's
no.
But it just brings the whole album down. I mean, it really does drag it on.
Yeah, not the best. Okay, guys, that's the two that were dropped. What we now need to do is agree on what the final song that is going to appear on the album.
Say live and let die.
Okay, everyone, Live and Let Die. It's time to make your case as to why a song should not feature on the Flaming Pie Supercut. So, who's up first for making a case as to why a song should not be on there? Let us spin the wheel. Okay, and it is Paul Nicholson. So, Paul, you did not have If You Wanna on your version of the album. Can you make the case as to why me and Paul should agree with you to keep it off? Oh, in fact, tell you what, we'll actually play a little bit of it first here. That would be probably a wise thing to do. So here is... Yes, I do want to do that. Let's go. Alrighty, that was If You Wanna, and that one does feature Steve Miller, definitely this time. So, Paul, take it away.
I just think I think it's a decent song. I don't think it's a bad song. It's much better than the two we just talked about. It just feels like there's quite a few of those songs, you know, the acoustic guitar high in the mix. And the bit that I do like in the song is the bridge. If you
Yes, that's good. That.
Mm-hmm. I like that bit. But mm-hmm. other than that, it's not... I just think it's too similar to other songs on the album. And that's why that would be my reason for taking it off. But it's not a bad song.
Okay.
I certainly don't think it's a bad song.
Okay, Paul Murphy, can you tell him why he's wrong?
I think it's a pretty good little song. I mean, it's but you know, the album needs to have faster songs on it, otherwise there's too many acoustic focus ones. I think the guitar sounds, you know, Steve Miller's guitar sounds really good on it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the lyrics are a bit kind of throwaway, but I think it's, you know, a bit of energy to it. It's one of the few songs that does have a nice bit of energy, so I'd have it in.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons why I had it on mine, because I actually swithered between this and Heaven on a Sunday, but we needed something a bit more up-tempo, so I went with If You Wanna, and the lyrics, yeah, you talked about the lyrics, I think that was just something, reading the notes on the album here, wanted to write something that would reflect America when you're driving across the desert, so yeah, I think that it does meet that. But yeah, for me, the verses actually remind me a lot of the things we said today from A Hard Day's Night. Just the kind of structure of the song. But yeah, I mean, it's not a song I love, but I think it's decent. And I think, Paul, you called it there, yeah, the part after the second chorus where, you know, well, if you want to love me, that's the best part in the song. Yeah. So yeah, no, I think it's decent and up-tempo, so that's why I'd keep it on there. Alrighty, let's move on to the next one, and I'm about to spin the wheel. Okay, and it is Paul Murphy. So you're going to be hating on Flaming Pie. Go!
So for me, this is... And going back to the album and sort of re-listening to it and looking at all the press material that went along with it, the PR push and everything.
Oh, in fact, Paul, sorry about that. We forgot to play it, didn't I? So... let me play it for our listeners. Here we go, sorry. Paul, you may continue. Apologies.
So it feels like, going back to it, it feels, maybe this is just, you know, like looking at it with slightly old, cynical eyes, it feels like a cynical play by McCartney to get a reference of Beatles in, to try and use it to try and promote the sale of the album. It's not a great song. It's, you know, I mean, this is like a throwaway song, something like Ubu Jubu or even Cosmically Conscious, which was like a tiny little snippet on off the ground. Instead, he's named the album after this. And it does feel like it just sort of ties into, you know, when you're looking at watching interviews from the time and it's like, oh, where did you get the title from? Well, you know, when John got this vision and Flaming Pies, Beatles. It just feels really cynical as a way to, if it'd been a great song, that'd be fine, but it's not a great song. And it is just a cynical way to get people going, oh, this is to do with the Beatles that you've just come off from the anthology, right? This will get people going out and buying it. And again, it sort of smacks too much of, I've said it before, it's like Paul McCartney has this habit of just taking on things that the other Beatles have done when they've gone. So like George... And then all of a sudden he's now playing what do you call it? Not ukulele. Is it ukulele? Mm. You know, and that's what George Harrison did. Paul McCartney didn't do that. It's a terrible it maybe be the album should never have been called that. It should have been called The Song We Were, because that ties in much more into the whole thing of it. And it's just a cynical ploy by McCartney to get journalists at the time asking questions what the name was so he could tie it into the Beatles. That's my argument.
Okay, so to confirm, Paul, you're not a fan of the song.
Don't beat around the bush, Paul. Just tell us how it is.
Don't beat around the pie. Yeah. Okay, Paul Nicholson, can you go with a rebuttal to that argument, please?
I certainly can, yes. I think it's a great song. I think it reminds me of Lady Madonna or something, like the sort of big jangly piano. And it's short as well, and Lady Madonna was quite short. So I don't know. I see it as, yeah, it sounds very like the Beatles, but I see that as it's a good thing in this sense.
The lyrics are terrible in it, Paul.
Like, they're good. The lyrics are very meaningful for me.
Stick my tongue out and lick my nose, tuck my shirt and zip my fly. I mean, like, that's like, I mean, if McCartney had released that 10 years before, he would have been slated for that. If he'd released that during Wings, he would have been. And then this again sort of sums up a bit of McCartney at the time where the critics weren't, they were like pandering to him at this point. They weren't criticizing him for it. If he'd released this before, if he'd released this in the Beatles, it would have been slated for it as well. I mean, you know, this would have been worse than You Know My Name, Look Up the Number.
Would he have said the thing, do you know, I'll change the lyrics later, but John said, keep it in. I know what that means.
Yeah, well, for me, I mean, I agree, Paul. I think it's very Lady Madonna-esque. But actually, on revisiting it, it's very obviously a Jeff Lynne production. I think it's a good song. So it's a nice rocker. It's playful. It's short. I think it's only about 2.5 minutes. And yeah, should the album have been called Flaming Pie based on the quality of the song? Yeah, I would agree with you, Paul. No, I think there's obviously better songs on the album. And you're probably right. Yeah, the song we were singing would have been a really, really good album title. Okay. Thank you both for that. So we're going to move on, and I am going to tell you why Heaven on a Sunday shouldn't be on that album. So let's just hear a little bit of it before we discuss it.
Peaceful, like heaven on a Sunday. Wishful, not thinking what to do. But it's a dream we're going through. And if I only had one love, yours would be the one I choose. If I
only... Alrighty, so why should this not be on the album? Because there were actually, when I think back when I had the CD of this and I played it, there were three songs that I always skipped. And that was one of them. I just found it very meh. And actually, in revisiting it again, I actually don't mind it all that much. It's obviously got a relaxed feel to it, the Sunday in the title, and the lyrics obviously all link into that as well. So it's fine, but it's, yeah, I just find it that it's... the third and fourth line tempo change in the verse is really nice, but other than that, it's just a bit middle of the road for me. Although I do laugh reading the notes, I think it's his son James appeared on this, and yeah, who appeared in a car crash interview years later when he really didn't want to be asked about his dad. But see, if you get the expanded version of this album and listen to the root cassette version of the song, it's much better. It's kind of more modern sounding. It's got a bit more bite and it's played at a higher tempo as well. So, yeah, I think if it went with a polished version of that one, it would have made it on the album. Because it did sound much more contemporary than this. But in its current form, yeah, it's fine. It's a bit middle of the road and boring. Please tell me I'm wrong. Did you have it on yours, Paul Murphy?
No, I didn't. No,
you didn't. Okay, so it's Paul, brother Paul. You're going to have to convince us.
Get arguing about son. That's what.
A son who's a happy chappy. Yes. Yeah. To be honest, I'm not a massive fan of the song. It was really, it was the least of the worst, if that makes sense. I don't mind that, but I'm not a massive fan of the song.
Okay.
But it's right. It's, well, adequate.
If that's the case, let us go straight into our voting for the song. So what I think we'll do is we will rate each of those three songs out of five, and the one with the highest number wins. So we're rating it out of five. Oh, yeah, Dancer. Man, you 3-2 up. So I tell you what, I'm missing some game tonight, aren't I? the ratings are: 1 is crap, 2 is poor, 3 is okay, 4 is good, 5 is great. So with that rating, Paul Murphy, can you give me your rating for Flaming Pie?
0.
Okay, Paul Murphy again for If You Wanna.
4.
Oh, okay.
Pretty generous.
And finally, Heaven on a Sunday.
2.
Okay. Same for you, Paul. Flaming Pie?
5.
Seriously?
Seriously? Mm-hmm. See, it's tactical voting, you see.
Uh-huh, okay. It's
like the election.
If you wanna...
3.
And Heaven on a Sunday?
3.
Okay, that leaves me. So Flaming Pie, I think, is good. So I'm giving it a 4. If You Wanna, I think, is probably just okay. So a 3 for that one. And Heaven on a Sunday, I think, is okay as well. So I'll give that a 3. So by using the power of maths, I can deduce from that that we do indeed have a winner. So Heaven on a Sunday got 8, Flaming Pie 9, and If You Wanna scored 10. So If You Wanna makes the cut, and the title track is banished. My goodness. All because of Paul Murphy. How are you going to sleep tonight, Paul Murphy?
Knowing that that all of a sudden we have a better album on the back of it.
Okay, so, well,
done our job.
Well, that's the job we're doing. So here's the songs that would appear. It is the... let me just run through them. So we've got the songs we were singing: The World Tonight, If You Wanna, Some Days, Young Boy, Calico Skies, Souvenir, Little Willow, Beautiful Night, and Great Day. I don't think I've missed any there, have I? Those are the 10 songs. So with that said, Paul Murphy, what did you rate the album before?
2.
You only rated it a 2 previously?
Yeah.
My God. Okay, what would you rate the TTMF supercut of Flaming Pie then?
3.
Alrighty. So Paul, yeah, I think you rated it 4 previously, didn't you?
Yes.
What would you give this... the TTMF supercut version?
It would stay the same because of Paul with his tactical voting taking Flaming Pie off.
Oh.
That's why, if that was on it, it would have got 5.
That just shows you how evil you are, Paul.
I know.
Don't you feel awful now?
You're being blamed for it.
Well, Mia gave the album a 4 previously, and I'm, let's see, somewhere tonight. I'm going to give it 4.5, because it is better with those songs being off. I would have liked Flaming Pie on there. I would have had 11 tracks on there. and I would have had Flaming Pie in the mix, but hey. Okay, great. Thank you very much, guys. And one of the things I did want to share with you is what the most popular song was from some of the Facebook Paul McCartney groups that were out there. So I asked the question, and I was just checking the kind of voting before we started the 5-2 United, get in. I was just checking the voting before we started the pod tonight. And do you want to have a guess as to what the favourite track was from, you know, real stalwart McCartney fans?
Flaming Pie.
From Flaming Pie.
It was not Flaming Pie.
The song Flaming Pie.
It was not.
Probably Beautiful Night, I would say.
Yeah, I would agree.
It was not Beautiful Night. That was joint second.
Young Boy?
It was not really Young Boy. It certainly wasn't that.
Little Willy?
Little Willy, yeah. Little Willow was the Little Willow was the favourite. And joint second was Souvenir and Beautiful Night. There you go. The Paul McCartney fans have spoken. So one final thing then, guys, is I know I do. Do we all prefer the TTMS supercut of Flaming Pie?
Oh, yeah.
No.
Definitely.
No, because my favourite song's not on it.
Oh, Paul Murphy. you really evil man. You
is a McCartney star song, but it had to come off. So
yeah, I agree.
Okay, guys, thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
So, guys, that's us near the end of the show. So what's your kind of parting thoughts on Flaming Pie?
Oh, well, for me, I think it's an album that, it could have been so much better if it just had a bit better production on it. It's like we spoke about the album sales being actually, you know, quite surprisingly low compared to Off the Ground, considering it always seemed like such a big selling album. I think it's a bit of a wasted opportunity. I think that what I think was really interesting about going back and listening to this was that McCartney lost out in the Grammy to Bob Dylan, Time Out of Mind. And, you know, and I went back and listened to that in Years Time Out of Mind, and it's an amazing album. And I think that's what it could have been like. Said it feels like, it's a bit half-baked.
Okay. What about you, Brother Paul?
I think it could have been so much better, but I still like it because for me, after like 10, 15 years, Paul McCartney was kind of ridiculed, that it was nice for him to get the credibility back that he deserved. So I see it as a happy time, quite an optimistic album, despite the fact, obviously, Linda's not well, but
yeah.
No, I think it's a really good album and it's a good memory, actually.
Yeah, I think for me it was a return to form, a return to relevance as well there for McCartney. I've really enjoyed re-listening to the album again, and it's been good to, I think, just pick up and I think do a deep dive into it about who produced what and finding out a little bit more about the history of each song as well. And also to realise that the songs that I really didn't care for originally back in the 90s are still the same ones, 25 years nearly later on. Okay, well, thank you both for that, and thank you, Paul Murphy, for joining us again as a guest. The next podcast we're going to do is going to be a bonus podcast on Flaming Pie, where we'll talk about each of our individual cuts of the album and how we would sequence them. We'll also talk about having seen Paul McCartney live, our thoughts on the concerts we've attended, and we'll also talk about what we might expect from McCartney in the future. Now, bearing in mind he's, what, 78 or 79 now? You know, which is incredible, but we'll have a talk about that anyway. So, thanks for listening, and you can listen to our show on all major podcast providers, including Apple, Google, and Spotify. Please give some 5-star reviews and positive comments. That would be appreciated. And a big shout out to all our new listeners, including those in Italy, a few more people in the US and Australia as well. So thanks for listening. We're on YouTube, and we keep hoping to put up some exclusive video content up there, and we'll get round to it eventually. So yeah, remember to like and subscribe there. And yeah, again, thanks to those who have recently subscribed to our channel. We're on Facebook and Instagram, so please join our Facebook group. We've had a few new people joining in the last couple of weeks, so good to see you on there. You can leave us voicemail via Anchor. You can email us at trimmingthemusicfat@gmail.com. You can also check us out on our website, which is www.trimmingthemusicalfat.com. So, it's been a beautiful night, but from that burning smell in the kitchen, I can tell my flaming pie is ready for supper. So until next time, thanks for listening, and goodbye.
Bye.
I'm going to run for a wee-wee, okay?
Hey, Jonesy. Rock it, man. I know you will. Do, do, do. Yeah.
I love it. I love it.